Welcome to the celebration of an extraordinary life and a time in the presence of the Lord. I know not everyone comes from the same background, but you walked into a Pentecostal church today, and we're here to lift up Jesus. And if you truly knew Sister Evelyn, you couldn't have known her long except to know that she was Pentecostal through and through. So as we remember her, as we pay tribute to her, and as we talk about this amazing spiritual giant who changed so many lives in her short time on this earth, I want to invite you, if you feel the presence of God, let's respond to the presence of God. If you feel like worshiping God, then nothing that you do today could be more appropriate than honoring Sister Evelyn by honoring God today. Amen? I want to start with some scripture out of one of Sister Evelyn's favorite chapters. This is John, the 14th chapter. Verse 1 says, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also." Verse 6 says, "Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." Verse 16 says, "And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you." Verse 26 says, "But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, I give unto you." And then again, Jesus said this, "Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid." This passage opens with, "Let not your heart be troubled," and it closes with Jesus saying the same, "Let not your heart be troubled." Today, our hearts are broken in this time of grief, this time of having to let go of something that we held so dear. But I'm thankful that I'm not going through this alone. And there's no one in this place today that needs to leave this service troubled. Because nothing that has happened, even Sister Evelyn stepping across into eternity, nothing that has happened in her life was out of God's plan for her. He had a perfect plan, and she served him with every ounce of her strength every day of her life. And today I'm so excited for her, knowing that she has finally heard those words she longed so much to hear from Jesus. "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of the Lord." Thank you, Jesus. So today, as we celebrate Sister Evelyn's life, I want you to understand that that same Holy Ghost, that same Comforter that I just read to you about, is already here in this place. and he came to touch you. He came to change you. He came to heal you. He came to bring peace and strength. And I believe that just because you've been in the presence of God, you're going to leave this service different than when you walked in. Would you please stand today if you're able as we pray? Would you bow your heads with me? Jesus, I thank you that you said in your word that where two or three gather in your name, that you will be in the midst of them. And Lord, we already feel your presence in this house today. Lord, I ask your anointing and your blessing upon every part of this service. I pray that you would begin even now, Lord, to mend the broken hearts and to touch the troubled minds through the power of your Spirit. And God, we just thank you for this opportunity. We thank you for this life that we're commemorating. And Lord, we just ask you to move in this homegoing service today in Jesus' name. And everybody said, Lord bless you. You may be seated.
I first met Sister Evelyn in 1989, Labor Day weekend. It was both of our first time at a conference. That was the second year of that conference, but it was the first year that just lay people could come. You know, it was a minister's conference before. It was called Advanced Christian Ministries. And I got there on Thursday night, and she got there on Friday. I think it was Friday morning, and when she got out of the car, there were either three, if not four, suitcases that she had with her. One of those was dedicated to her shoes, I just want you to know. She had a lot of shoes. And it was campgrounds, so it's like, okay, where's she going to wear these? She wore them. And it was her first time with people that were not like her. But what she found out is that we were exactly like her.
Amen.
And she recognized the power of the Holy Ghost within us. And we all just fell in love with each other. And she and I became great friends that weekend. And then just a few months later, I met Darlene, and then I met Dennis, and Tanya. And we've been close ever since. We just love each other. So this is as sad as this moment is for me and for all of us, that we won't get to hug her again. It's a great honor that I've been asked to sing and participate. I want you to know that. We're singing about heaven today. She wanted to go. Now she's there.
They say that heaven's pretty, but living here. But if they said that I would have to choose between the two, I'd go home. I'm going home where I belong. Sometimes when I'm dreaming, it comes as no surprise that if you look, you'll see that homesick feeling in my eyes. 'Cause I'm headed home, I'm going home where I
while I'm here, I'll serve.
when I'm feeling blue. It's such a joy to know that I am only passing through, 'cause I'm going home. I'm headed home where I belong. But while I'm here, I'll serve Him gladly and sing Him all these songs. Yeah, I'm here.
I'm here. Oh,
but not for long. At my door, but I'll awake to find that I'm not homesick anymore, 'cause I'll be home.
At this time, Tanya, one of Evelyn's daughters, is coming to talk about her life.
Hello. As Pastor Doug said, I'm Tanya, Evelyn's daughter. As you know, and as Glenn just mentioned, my mama liked to dress up. Always, never left the house, didn't even get out of the house without her hair not done. I haven't gotten dressed up in a very long time. And I was wanting to do my mama proud, and I did something really stupid, and I got a spray tan. So I'm really sorry I look like a pumpkin at my mama's funeral. I had to just address it because I look like a pumpkin. First of all, I just want to say thank you so much for coming. And I know some of you have traveled so far to be here, and I just want you to know what your presence means to me and my family. Thank you for being here. And I'm up here today because I had the honor of writing my mom's obituary. My family asked me to share that with you today, so I'm going to read that to you. I wanted to be the one to write it because I just thought that could be my gift to her, to honor her in that way. I have a lot of family members who are musically talented, and I did not get that at all. I don't play any instruments. When I sing, usually people ask me to stop. My kids are here. They'll tell you that's true. I'm not a preacher like she had hoped I would be. She would have even settled if I married a preacher. that didn't happen either. Funny story though. She used to say early on in life, way years and years ago, she would say, "Well, what about you and Doug?" But but I guess that means Nate's the preacher's wife she always wanted, huh? So anyway, since I wasn't able to give her any of those things, I thought my gift to her, which would be what I thought is the one way I, probably the gift that God gave me, is my words. I write for a living, so I thought I would do that for her, but honestly, it was the hardest thing I've ever done in my life, is to try to express how I feel about her in words, especially in the length of an obituary. My mom loved me so hard, and I don't know what I'm going to do without her, honestly, and especially without her prayers. She prayed mighty, and even, you know, every night when she would call, sometimes I'd be with my friends who also came from California, Saul and Stephanie. I'd put her on speakerphone so she could pray for them too. She always included you guys in her prayer, so it was always fun when we could do that together. And sometimes we would be out with other people, and everybody knew when Mama called, the room would get silent. And everybody bowed their head. And even as weak as she had gotten, you could just feel the fierceness through her prayers. So I also thought a lot about how I wanted to include all those feelings into her obituary, but also her love for all of you as her church family. I know she loved you very, very hard as well. And so saying all that to say, that was a lot to compress and put in an obituary, but here we go, I'm gonna try it. On March 21st, 1935, the world was gifted with an angel, Evelyn Schave. While her wings were invisible to most, since that beautiful day of her earthly birth, she illuminated light to everyone she met. Evelyn preached her first sermon at the young age of 8 years old, which was only the beginning of a lifetime dedicated to demonstrating God's grace and compassion. Even when faced with opposition, her faith and kindness were unshakable. Through tears, she prayed with the fierceness of a warrior. If you were fortunate enough to be present during one of her sermons, you not only felt the hand of God, but you probably felt the nudge of her fingers, as Howard put the Holy Ghost smack. And you probably also felt the swoosh of her ink. Thank you for thanking me. She was called back to home on September 8th, 2024, with her husband, Dennis Schave, daughters Darlene Bernard and Tanya Geshen, daughter-in-law Marilyn Beben, and granddaughter April Gedney by her side. She's also mourned by brothers, sisters, sons, daughters, grandkids, great-grandkids, great-great-grandkids, nieces and nephews, and the thousands of lives who felt the warmth of her brightness from all around the globe. Evelyn's return to heaven was rejoiced by her fellow angels, and she was greeted at the gates by her son Rocky Leister, grandsons Micah McGarrett and Rocky Pratt, and many of her brothers and sisters in Christ, who I know many of you know, who we've lost, including our mamas are together now. Almost done. In lieu of flowers, her family asks that you carry on her radiance. Love each other unconditionally, accept each other without judgment, pray for each other intensely. And for goodness sake, never, ever go on your day without your hair done. And it's always best to stay prepared by holding on to your hanky.
See her in the grave.
At this time, Evelyn's granddaughter, April, is coming to share some of her memories with you.
Oh, goodness. Evelyn Schave was indeed a mighty woman of God that we all knew, but I knew her as Grandma. She was my pastor throughout my childhood and even my Sunday school teacher. Every memory I have of her, going as far back as I can remember, is how she lived her life with such discipline. She had her prayer time. She had her Bible study time, as she had her family time, and God always came first. Here are some of the things that I cherished about her, and there are many, so please bear with me. As a child, I would sit on the front pew with her during church, and she would grab my hand to check my fingernails to make sure that they were clean. And I'm sorry, Grandma, my fingernails are a mess today. When I sat down next to her, I would always get 3 love pats, either on the leg or on the hand, but always 3. The way she would thank me for doing anything that I did for her with, "Thank you, sweet baby." She was always so gracious and so thankful, even for the smallest gestures, like bringing her a Big Red. When something really tickled her, as she would say, she had a certain shriek of laughter that was contagious. Most times when Tanya, my mom, and I got together, we would inevitably end up being silly, and it usually ended up with her saying, "Oh, you girls." Tanya and I even tried to show her how Snapchat filters worked. She was not impressed. And those videos are safe in the vault forever. she had a great sense of humor. During our high school years, she would sometimes drive Tanya and I to school. And she thought it would be a funny tradition to start anytime she saw a school bus in front of us or to the side of us. She thought it would be funny to lay on the horn and start honking while Tanya and I would duck down as far as we could. And she would just laugh and laugh and then keep honking. And she could cook. My favorite meals were her taco salad, always made in her blue and white pot, her pancakes with homemade chocolate syrup and crispy bacon, her cornbread casserole at Thanksgiving, and her chili, where she always shared, she added corn for color. Although no one is perfect, she certainly is the closest thing I have ever seen. Throughout my life, not once did she ever make me feel like a failure, even when I was struggling or at my lowest. She always had words of encouragement. If she knew there was a need, she would stop everything, and I'm sure we've all experienced to pray right then and there. Over the past year, as she grew weaker, I could tell it was a struggle for her to even pray at times, but nothing would stop her. Even in her weaker voice, she had such power in her prayer. One of the most cherished moments that I will hold on to was about a week before she passed. My mama, Tanya, and I were sitting on her bed with her during her scripture time, and she paused and looked at us and said, "You girls are my joy." And looking back, maybe she knew her time was coming. But what an honor to have her share that, given what an amazing woman she was, all that she had accomplished throughout her life, and us silly girls were her joy. "Grandma, I will try to live my life without you in a way that you would be proud. I will miss the sound of your voice, your love pats, your laughter, and your prayers. I know you were ready, even though we were not, and I know you're celebrating your life's work and are so deserving of your eternal reward. I can only imagine the welcome home celebration you received. How heaven erupted with praise as our Heavenly Father congratulated you with, 'Well done, thy good and faithful servant.' Even with my grandma's passing, she's still working. Shortly after she passed, I came across a Facebook post written by someone that my grandma had greatly touched. I reached out to her and actually felt an immediate connection. So I would like to share Krista Ingram Ortega's tribute to my grandma that she wrote. I think these words represent just what an impact that she had. "Lord, prepare me for the road ahead and let my faith do the walking. The world shifted a bit yesterday as many of us, particularly in the LGBTQ community, found out about the passing of Evelyn Schave. Our hearts and prayers are with the whole family as many of us consider her family as well. It's hard to form a string of words to explain this loss because the heaviness isn't just for each of us individually, but collectively. We lost a piece of us last night that molded us into children of God when so many didn't even believe we could be at the same table. Evelyn was that bridge. She laid hands, she preached, she listened, she cried with us. She spoke life into us. She was full of fire, yet at times so calm you could hear a pin drop. A few funny moments, she'd ask someone if they needed money if they came to church in ripped jeans. then said, 'Well, maybe they're holy jeans.' She never wanted us to be the victim of our circumstance, but victorious in Jesus. And when she'd say his name, it could move a whole room. She was never scared to get close to others who would keep her at an arm's distance. She led so many to Jesus and gave him all the glory.
It hurts knowing so many won't ever know her, but I know her legacy will truly live on forever. Thank God for Schave Ministries. And I'm almost done, I promise. Grandma, you are leaving a mighty legacy. The lives you touched, the hearts you helped heal, the ministries you birthed will never be forgotten and will continue. I have no doubt you'll be the first one to welcome me home when I get there. I love you.
If it's bandaging the broken, or washing filthy feet, here I am, Lord, send me. If it's loving one another, even when we don't agree, here I am, Lord, send me. If I'm poor, if I'm wealthy, I'll serve you just the same. Here I am, Lord, send me. On the mountain or the valley, I will choose to praise. Here I am.
Here I am, Lord, and save me. with everything, with all my dreams, with all my hopes, how I love you, God. You can have it all. You can have it all.
Tanya's son and Sister Evelyn's grandson, Justin, is coming to talk a little bit about his grandmother.
Whew, that's a tough one to follow up. Whew, give me a sec. Like you said, my name is Justin. A lot of people, obviously. Bear with me, I got this. Everybody knew her as Evelyn, except for me. Or some, we knew her as Grandma. But I wanted to note on something real quick before I get going. Through that PowerPoint and in the photo, that girl knew how to dress. I mean, find one photo that she did not look absolutely fabulous. I mean, she, that girl, man. And like, I mean, you said it too. Like, she walked out the door, she was dressed to the nine. I mean, she was always in her Sunday best. So, and I thought that was hilarious. But yeah, I mean, so, all right, let's get going. So I wanted to bring up some memories that I had in my past that I thought would be good just to share, some silly ones that I've held on to. When I was young, we lived in Oregon, and we didn't get to see them very often because they lived here in Arizona. But they came up to visit one time, and we just thought it was so funny. I mean, everybody knows it. She was a lover and not a fighter. And even though, side note, even though she is a small person, man, that girl had a voice. And we came one time to our church service, not knowing what she did. And I was like, man, I wish these chairs had seatbelts because I need a strap in, because there is the Spirit of the Lord coming. Woo! That girl, man, I was like, small frame, big voice. Wow. But anyway, but yeah, so when we were in Oregon, we didn't get to see them very often. But during the time, my father was in Portland SWAT, and he would bring his stuff home. And we thought, because of her small demeanor, that we think it'd be funny to put her in all the SWAT gear, you know? So thinking her with a bulletproof vest and a gun that probably weighed more than she did. And I wish we had that photo, but it was a sight to be seen, and it was so funny. But man, she didn't understand it, but she was such a person that would just go with the flow. You know, like, she thought we knew it was funny, and she's like, I'll do it, let's do it. Another one that I thought was fantastic years later was, another time, we lived in California now, and she decided to make Texas chili, which I believe you talked about it, and it was famous for some, but infamous for others. I loved her, but man, I would never a chili person, and that was, I would have to always make excuses like, oh, I'm not hungry, oh, I'm just not feeling right now, to get out of it. But there was one day that there was no way around it. It was just, I was like, I'm going to figure this one out, I'm going to eat it, and here we go. But so, out of the kindness of her heart, she decided to make dinner for us, and she made Texas chili. But when she decided to stow it away, I don't know if everybody knows, but when you put a scalding hot liquid into a plastic container, it melts. So, we didn't think that one through, so we poured scalding hot Texas chili in this plastic container, and immediately we saw this thing, like, and all over the floor, and I was like, thank you, God. I was like, he was looking out that day. I was like, about that man. I was like, didn't want to tell her, you know, but I was like, that, thank you. I was like, man, I locked out on this one. I don't know how, I mean, the cleanup sucked, but I was like, you know what? I could live to see another day of not eating Texas chili, even though it was her staple. I mean, she loved it, and a lot of people did. Just, I was a picky kid, you know? I liked my more chicken nuggets. That was more my speed, but it was cool. Throughout the years, she knew, like, me and Jared, my brother, we were into action figures. So every Christmas, she'd bring us action figures for Christmas. And, like, she did not miss a beat, her and Grandpa. I mean, they were so on it. They were so, so thoughtful. And even though we didn't get to speak all the time, they knew exactly what we wanted. And when we grew up, it turned to video games. And even though I liked Call of Duty, I liked war games, she would call them the shoot 'em up games. But she accepted it. She knew I liked it. So every birthday, every Christmas, she'd give us a GameStop gift card. She knew, you know, it wasn't her favorite that I was playing those, but she knew we loved it. And she loved us, so that's what she was going to do. And then when that time passed and we moved out, it turned to just cash, because sometimes it's nice to have a little extra. Like, I was like, that's awesome. I was like, for, you know, a struggling college kid, cash is great. So it was awesome. But she was so sweet, her aunt, grandpa, and they just, even though we didn't talk, I mean, that often, we didn't get to see them. They always were looking out for us, and I just love that. But, all right, that's going to be the top one. Ready? So finally, I just want to say that I think we need to not mourn the loss, but celebrate the honor of knowing her. So, all right, got through it. Thank you. We did it.
In my moments of fear, through every pain, every tear, there's a God who has been faithful to me. When my strength was all gone, when my heart had no song, still in love, my God proved faithful to me. Every word that he promised is true. And what I thought was impossible, I've seen my God do. He's been faithful to me. And looking back, his love and mercy I see. My heart, I have questioned, even failed to believe, yet he's been faithful to me. When my heart looked away, the many times I could not pray, still my God, he was faithful to me. The days I spent so selfishly, reaching out for what pleased me, still my God, he proved faithful to me. And every time I come back to him, he is waiting with open arms, and I see once again. He's been faithful, so very faithful to me. And looking back, his love and mercy I see. Though in my heart I have questioned, even failed to believe, yet he been faithful, he's been faithful, faithful. Ooh, in my heart I have questioned, even failed to believe, yet he's been faithful, he's been faithful. Oh, in my heart questioned, I've even failed to believe, yet he's been faithful, he's been faithful to me. My God's been faithful to
Is there anybody that can say he's been faithful to you? Would you raise your hand if you know that God is the only reason you are where you are today? Amen. He's faithful. He's faithful. Sister Evelyn would tell you today, no matter what she ever went through, God never failed her, not one moment. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Darlene, Evelyn's oldest daughter, is coming to talk about her mom.
Everyone that has attended today to give honor to my beautiful mama. And if you knew her, you loved her. I wanted to do this all, and you'll get why I'm doing it. I have a hanky. Mama's done. Mama just did that. I did it. Mama's notebook. Mama's Bible. I was contemplating what to say today. Just couldn't find the words to express how much my sweet mama means to me. How she exuded unconditional love to all. I would start, throw away the paper, did it several times. Then I felt like I had a Lord to Darlene experience. And what he was saying to me was, don't speak your words, speak hers. Months ago, Mom told me the Lord was giving her a new sermon. She said, God must not be done with me if he's still giving me a sermon. My response was, no, Mama, God is not done with you. So I decided to get out this thing in me. So I decided to get out her Bible and read through her last notes. And then there it was, her last sermon. There is no way I can deliver this very short version of her sermon with the anointing that Mom has. But I do not want Mama's last sermon to go unheard. So, okay, Mama, here we go. The title of her sermon, Keep the Faith, Jesus is Coming. Hebrews 11:1, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. 1 Corinthians 16:13, watch, stand fast in the faith, be strong. Mama loved Webster, so here we go. Webster's definition of faith, complete trust or confidence in someone or something. We must have faith to be saved. We must have faith to even pray. We can't see God, but He knows He hears us. Right. We must have faith to believe that the Bible is the Word of God. And we must have faith to believe that Jesus is returning for His church. Hebrews 9:28. So Christ was offered once to bear the sins of many. To these who eagerly wait for Him, those that have faith, He will appear a second time apart from sin for salvation. In His word, prophecies and signs were given to watch for. Look at our world today. People all over the world are running asunder trying to find the answers that will stop all the confusion and craziness and turn things around for mankind. Because we have faith as the children of God, we know what the answers are. Mark 13:32-33. But of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Take heed, watch, pray, for you do not know when this time is. And I say to you, watch. Stay strong in your faith. Keep faith and rest assured that Jesus is getting ready to split the clouds of glory. And those of us that know Him and have faith and have accepted Him are going to meet Him. Are going to meet Him. So keep the faith. No matter what is going around about us, keep the faith, church. Jesus is coming.
Surveyed all the good things that come to me from above, if I could count all the blessings from the storehouse of love, I'd simply ask for a favor of Him beyond mortal men, and I'm sure that He'd rest.
I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day when all my troubles and heartaches are vanished away. Then we'll enjoy the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven with you. So many places of beauty we long to see here below, but times and treasures have kept us from making plans, as you know. But come the morning of the rapture, together we'll stand anew. Then we'll stroll with you.
Heaven with you.
A dear friend in the ministry and host of the Schaves for many years, Pastor Tony Certain, would you come at this time?
Well, first of all, I'm so honored to be able to stand today to speak over such a wonderful person as Sister Schave. I'm so honored that Sister Schave was the first minister to ever minister in our church besides me. And I've always considered Sister Evelyn my pastor, because so many times over the years she's been the one that's guided me through the decisions I needed to make. Upon my first meeting of Sister Schave, I met her 28 years ago in McDonald, Tennessee. I'd been invited to come and hear her preach, and I didn't want to hear her preach because they told me about this little old white-headed straight lady that was preaching in churches like ours. And I'm like, so why do I want to go way up there in the sticks to hear her, of all people? So I go to church that night to hear Evelyn Schave. And before we left that night, we had already sat and talked, and she was to be the first speaker at our church anniversary that year. And after that, she preached 24 years in a row at our church for our anniversary. And after the first year, Sister Schave had told me she wasn't quite sure that I was going to make it. Because I had came out of a Church of Christ upbringing. And of course, the Holy Ghost and all those things were new to me. And she told me that if I didn't get right with the Holy Ghost, she wouldn't see me in a year. But luckily after that, I saw her for 24 years in a row. She was with me through so many ups and downs over the years, even though she might not be there in person. I've called her over numerous church members that were going home to glory, and Sister Evelyn would be the last person they were hearing, as she would be praying as they were leaving this world. And I thought about that over those times I'd heard her at our church, I went back and found all the places that we had been traveling together. And we had been in 11 different states in these 28 years. And I had heard her preach 96 times. 96 times. And I feel sorry for today that people that never had that one chance to hear Evelyn Schave. I think about all the people's lives that I was lucky enough to see that she touched. Those kids that come to our altar that mom and daddy didn't love them. But there's this old white-headed lady that has came to their church and is telling them that God loves them just like they are. Or people like me, pastors, that didn't exactly understand. I'll give you this story, and I'm not going to give them in. I'll be like Naomi. Sister Evelyn was with me, and we were at a class in Dayton, Ohio. And it was a wonderful service, and we were sitting together, and it was strange that we were sitting kind of back in the church because she always wanted us to sit on the front row. And Brother Dennis didn't travel with her as much then. And we were sitting together during praise and worship, and all of a sudden, it went from extremely noisy to extremely quiet. So someone went to stand up to give a word, and I'm praying, Lord, I don't want to know. Whatever it is you got to say, let somebody else tell it. I don't need to be the one to give up and get this message. Because I had never done that before. This was like the third time I had seen that happen. And I'm like, Lord, no, I don't want to get up. I don't want to get up. I don't want to get up. Well, about that time, Sister Evelyn took a hunk out of my left leg. Because she was beside me, and it was like something had pushed her out of her seat. So she gave the message, and we went back into service. So after service, I got one of those conversations she had with me, because had I done what God told me to do, she wouldn't have had to got up. So I always remember that anytime I was where and somebody stood up to give a message, I was always very intent to say, okay, God, I'm ready. Sister Evelyn's sitting out there, so I'm ready. And then ever since Brother Dennis had talked to me about Sister Evelyn's health declining, I kept getting this same scripture I want to share with you before I sit down. It's out of Hebrews, the 12th chapter, which says, therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto him, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despite the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. I kept thinking that scripture of Sister Evelyn as she left this world and was greeted by those that have gone on. I thought about church members that I know for a fact that were members of our church that didn't know Jesus but made it through those gates because of Evelyn Schave. And I think about how happy she was when she got there, and because of her, those people were greeting her when she got there. So I'm so thankful that I know that when the day when God calls me home, that I'll be able to pick out that little white-headed lady shaking her handkerchief at me when I arrive.
I'm Cheyenne. Some of y'all know me, some of you don't. I met Sister Schave in Houston when I was very young. And she's really the sole reason why I stand before you today behind this mic, because she's the first one that saw that in me and encouraged me to see if I'm going to gather myself. I'm going to fix my makeup. And I'm going to do this song for her for one last time. So here we go. I did not know of a place I could go, where I could find a way to heal my wounded soul. He said that I could come into his presence without fear, into this holy place where his mercy hovers near. I'm running to the mercy seat where Jesus is calling. He said his grace would cover me, his blood will flow freely, it will provide my healing. I'm running to the mercy seat. I'm running to the mercy seat. Are you living where hope has not been? You're lost in a curse of a lifetime of sin. Lovely illusions, they never come true. I know where there's a place of mercy for you. To his presence without fear, into this holy place where his mercy hovers near. Come run.
Serving as the Chief Presiding Presbyter of the Fellowship of Reconciling Pentecostals International. I'm very sorry that I was not able to be present for this service. Sister Evelyn meant such a great deal to our fellowship, and the impact of her ministry reaches far into our lives. During our general conference in 2021 in Phoenix, at where you are today, KingdomGate Pentecostal Church, RPI took the first step in its history of honoring both Sister Evelyn and Brother Dennis Schave for their enormous contributions to our community. Throughout their ministry, they have touched countless lives through their preaching, through their teaching, and their very loving presence. Sister Evelyn was very well known for her style of ministry, as she preached the gospel always with the aid of her hanky. I do not believe I was ever in a service where Sister Evelyn ministered. Also, that those in the front row did not receive some sort of special involvement in her message, usually by way of a light punch or hand on the shoulder. When you met Sister Evelyn, you immediately felt the love that she carried with her. It was a love for God and a deep love for people. This love was something that cost both Sister Evelyn and Brother Dennis a lot as they branched out to minister to the GLBTQ+ community. But through it all, they carried the banner of Jesus Christ to all who would hear and receive the message. I remember quite vividly the first time I met Sister Evelyn. It was at an RPI General Conference several years ago in Columbus, Ohio. I was new to the world of Pentecost and was sitting near the back of the sanctuary. And during the altar call, she pointed at me and said, "Come down here," in a very loving but yet firm tone. She spoke over my life and prayed for me that day, and I recall feeling such an anointing from God in that moment. I am sure we all have a story like this one, where we first met Sister Evelyn, where she preached a message that impacted our lives, where she spoke to us and encouraged us to keep moving forward in our walk with God. Sister Evelyn has finished her race and her fight is now won. I know today that she has joined the great cloud of witnesses that cheer us on to our individual finish lines. Sister Evelyn, we honor you, your ministry, and the impact that you have had on our world. Brother Dennis, know that the RPI family is holding you up as well as your family up in our thoughts and in our prayers. We honor Sister Evelyn, and my prayer today is that we will all continue running the same race with the same determination that she had. May God bless each of you.
My name is Reverend Linda Adkins, and I serve on the Board of Presbyters with RPI. Take just a moment, and on behalf of the Board of Presbyters and the entire Fellowship of Reconciling Pentecostals International, we're going to offer up this plaque, a memorial in honor of not only her ministry and her true servanthood to this entire organization. I'm going to read the inscription, a poem that is inscribed, "The voice of God that saved me called for me to go to a people only I could reach with a message they should know. Leaving all, we just said yes to revelation God bestowed. With a hanky in my Bible, his love no boundaries show. Many souls this message changed. I'll stand before my Lord and say, I have fought my fight. I have kept the faith. And I wait now for my eternal reward. Not only with love from Reconciling Pentecostal Assembly, but we gift this to the founder emeritus of this fellowship, Pastor Doug Clanton, and it will be placed at Kingdom Gate. Thank you.
You may be seated. As we begin to reach the latter part of this service, I feel butterflies in my stomach because I know it's time to say goodbye to someone that changed my life, to someone whose life I watched over 30 years change the lives of others time and time again. Psalm 116 and verse 8 says this: "For thou hast delivered my soul from death, mine eyes from tears, and my feet from falling." Today, Sister Evelyn is not suffering anymore. She's not fighting with her health issues. She's not looking toward the end, because I want you to understand something. It is appointed once for man to die and then to be judged. Sister Evelyn simply kept her appointment. No power in heaven or hell could have taken her 1 second before God was ready for her. But today she stands in the presence of a holy God, delivered from death. She'll never face that final struggle ever again. Her eyes will never be filled with tears again. And those frail feet will never have to be in danger of falling ever again. Verse 10 of this same chapter says this: I believed, therefore have I spoken. I believed, therefore have I spoken. As I came across this, and as a pastor of many years and a minister of over 40 years, I've preached a lot of funerals, and I have come to this very chapter because of the scripture that I'm going to read in a moment down the list a little ways. But when I came across verse 10, it had Sister Evelyn written all over it. Because every time she took the pulpit, or even just engaged in conversation about God, and I'll just tell you that it didn't matter what you wanted to talk about, she would talk about the Lord. And her belief came out in everything that she did. And I'll tell you, she would zero in on people. And she would begin to minister to them. And the Holy Ghost inside of her would begin to cause things to happen around her because of the power of God that resided within her. And there was something about every word that she spoke. You didn't have to wonder whether that woman believed what she was saying or not. She believed, therefore she spoke. And when she spoke, the anointing of God was upon every word, and lives were changed, and hearts were brought back to God. As I came to know her, it was about 30 years ago, and I was in a place of just finding my way back to ministry. Had been in ministry for years, and had, like so many, had walked away because somebody made it clear that there was no place for me at the table any longer. But I'll just tell you that I went to a revival in Houston, Texas, and Sister Evelyn was preaching. The group that I was traveling with was singing, and she did that zero in thing where there was nobody else in the room except for you. And she said, I want to tell you something. She said, I don't care what anyone else has ever said to you. God is not finished with his promises over your life. God still has a place for you, and God is still going to use you. Well, Sister Evelyn, I'm still preaching the word of God to a lost and dying world 30 years later. Verse 15 of that chapter says, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. This is a precious moment to God. I believe that God's heart has been touched by this time and this loss. The word of God in the book of Hebrews says this, that we have not a high priest who can't be touched by the feeling of your infirmities. I want you to know that God understands everything that you're going through. Brother Dennis, I can't imagine what you are going through today. 50 years plus married to this incredible woman. All of the family, I don't pretend to understand what you're going through. But I'm going to share just a little bit of what I am going through, because I was given an assignment that no one else had in Sister Evelyn's life. Yes, she ministered in other churches, but early on she and I traveled together, preached camp meetings, conferences, revivals all over the country. for years before I became a pastor, and then once in a while after. But as soon as I became a pastor, Sister Evelyn, who called me Doug, stopped calling me Doug. And I was pastor to her. And she and Brother Dennis were part of this church from the very beginning, 23 years ago. Brother Dennis was in the very first service, and Sister Evelyn was traveling somewhere that day, but when she returned, she was a faithful part of our church. And even when they moved away to Texas for a ministry opportunity, when things would happen in her life, she would get me on the phone, and she would say, "Pastor, I don't know what to do." You may not have seen the side of her that I got to see. Sister Evelyn was afraid sometimes. Sister Evelyn was confused sometimes. Sister Evelyn was discouraged sometimes. She was human after all. But even through all of that, she was able to stand in the pulpit and to minister to others. When she faced cancer, she called me and asked me what God thought she should do. I had another pastor one time say, "Aren't you intimidated being her pastor?" And I said, "No, I'm not, because God has given me that gift and that relationship with her that nobody else has." Even though she was in another pastor's church at that time, she called me and I would guide her and I would give her advice as I heard from God. In some of our travels, a lot of funny things happened, and it's already been said that Sister Evelyn could laugh like nobody else. I think you might call it more of a squeal. And I'll never forget, we were together in Fort Worth, Texas. I believe it was camp meeting, but it may have been a revival. And Sister Evelyn was preaching a theme of messages: God, stop here. Don't pass us by. God, stop here. And so the church took it upon themselves, all across one of the side walls of the church in huge gold letters. We came in and it said, "God, stop here," the theme of what she was preaching. Of course, as the revival went on, the very last E on the very last word fell off. And so we walked into service and across the wall it said, "God, stop her." But she had a sense of humor about it. She called me for everything. And as a busy person with a secular job and traveling myself for work, traveling for ministry, pastoring the church, founding, reconciling Pentecostals International, I couldn't always answer the phone for just anyone that called. But there were three people that I would answer the phone for no matter what was going on or what I was in the middle of, because I knew they weren't calling to waste my time or to say something unimportant. I would get back to the rest, but one of them was my husband, one was my mother, and one was Sister Evelyn. And when she called, I knew that she had a serious need. I wasn't always sure I was the right person to be called in that moment. I remember when she and Brother Dennis lived in a very large house and the shed out on the property caught fire somehow. And my phone rings and she said, "Pastor, my house is on fire." I said, "What are you talking about? Your house is on fire." "It's on fire." I said, "Why are you calling me? Are you safe? Why don't you get out of the house? How about the fire department? Did you call?" "No, I called you." She knew her pastor could fix anything. Wow. Sister Evelyn was one of the most incredible encouragers on the face of the earth that I have ever had the pleasure of knowing. From the very first moment that I met her to the very last conversation I had with her, she was encouraging me, even as she was getting ready to step into eternity. Many of us are here today because of her encouragement, her prayers. And I will tell you this, I will miss the prayers of that godly woman in my life, because when she said, "I'm praying for you, Pastor, every day I'm praying for you," I knew she wasn't just speaking empty words, but she brought me before the throne of God, and I will miss that. I want to share a little bit of scripture and share, much like what Darlene shared with you, I want to share with you some things from the very last message that she was able to preach. She preached it right here in her home church, Kingdom Gate Pentecostal Church, and I'll never forget it. You might want to go online and watch it. It's about 15 minutes long because she couldn't be up front as long in the latter times that she preached. But this was October 30th, 2022, almost 2 years ago. And she preached a message entitled, "Be Not Deceived or Troubled." I will tell you that Sister Evelyn believed that Jesus was coming back. She knew from her head to her toe that she needed to talk about the fact that he was coming back and that we all better be ready for his return. And one of her favorite passages to preach from was Matthew 24. And that last message she preached was no exception. She preached Matthew 24. Verse 4 said this, "Take heed that no man deceive you." She said in that message, we must pray and seek God in this hour, for the coming of the Lord is nigh. Then she went to Hebrews, the 13th chapter, and she read a scripture, "I will never leave thee nor forsake thee." And then she talked about in Matthew 24 that there would be wars and rumors of wars, earthquakes in diverse places, and so on, when Jesus was telling us what to look for at the end times. But then she focused in on what Jesus said in that place, and it is the same message that I began this service with. See that you be not troubled. Verse 8 in Matthew 24 says that all of these things are the beginning of sorrows. And she began to talk about that. But then she said this, church, don't be troubled about it. She said, this is the beginning of sorrows. But I want to give you a quote. She said, even though all of these things are going to come to pass and are coming to pass, we can shout right through them. Thank you, Jesus. She said, God puts his anointing upon his people, and we got to let God have his way. Sister Evelyn was a shouter. And if you don't know what that means, then just see some of the family or myself after church, and we will explain it to you. It's not the same as yelling, but it is responding to the power of the Holy Ghost. And when I had the opportunity to sit with Sister Evelyn for the very last time, and she wasn't really coming to the surface much at that time, and the family was around her. Tanya and Darlene were there, Brother Dennis. I came in and I began to talk to her. Sister Evelyn, this is Doug. And all of a sudden her eyes opened and she said, Pastor. I held her hand. I talked to her. I prayed with her. I cried with the family. And then it came time for me to go, we were having general conference here at the church that weekend. And I said this, I said, Sister Evelyn, I'm going to have to go now. But if I don't see you again, I'm going to see you on the streets of gold. And we'll meet again in heaven. She could barely even keep her eyes open. But at that moment, her eyes opened and her fist came up. And she said, we're going to shout. Today, I believe she's shouting on streets of gold in the presence of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the Savior that meant everything to her. She believed, therefore she spoke. She believed, therefore she preached the gospel of the kingdom of God. She believed, even revelations that God brought to her that caused other churches not to want her around any longer. She paid the price because she believed what God had spoken to her. She believed that it doesn't matter who you are, but whosoever comes to God, whosoever believes in Him shall be saved. Whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. She believed, therefore she spoke. And because she spoke, lives were changed. 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter, says this. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible. And we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption. And this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? Today, I wonder if you would stand to your feet and begin to worship God, and somebody let out a shout of worship, because death has lost its battle, and death today has been swallowed up in victory. Hallelujah! Thank you, Jesus. Oh, God, we bless your name, God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. You may be seated.
There's a river that flows like crystal and water.
a jasper tomb. The street in front of my house is made of purest gold, and it's a place is an address.
Change notification. I'm moving to a much better place.
And there will be no
tears, no sorrow. There'll be no more pain. This is to tell you.
Of you may be seated. I'm going to ask that the funeral directors come. We're going to open the casket one last time and give you an opportunity to come and say farewell, so long, but we're going to meet again, to Sister Evelyn. We have a hope today. And if you know Jesus the way Sister Evelyn knows Jesus, this is not the final goodbye. But we know we will meet again. Thank you, Jesus.
Hear him say to me, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. You have kept the faith."
Mind. I will no longer sit at the gate.
and just sit there and watch everybody else go by and watch everybody else receive. Because I'm ready to step over to the other side of the gate. I'm going to go through. That is where my answer is. On the other side of the gate.
I'm waiting my whole life to hear you I hear that sound, all of heaven's angels crying out, singing, holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Singing, holy, holy, holy.
People that will stand firm in faith, no matter what it looks like, no matter what it appears to be. God has a people that's going to stand by faith. Hallelujah. We're going to encourage each other. Brother, you stand. Because, yes, faith will carry you through.